Hey guys, how's it going? Today I'm gonna be showing you how I made this awesome thankful tray. We got multiple colors of epoxy, splines on the edges, and it's all made on the CNC. We do have plans available for it on our website, so be sure to check those out. There's a link down in the description. Without further ado, let me show you how I made it. Starting on a new project here to make a thankful tray. We do sell the plans on our website, so definitely check those out there. And we're getting the piece of half-inch Baltic birch plywood sucked down to the StepCraft M1000 CNC using the vacuum table and the Fine Turbo 1 vacuum, all available on our website. So I'm using the RC-1141 90-degree V insert bit here to go through and carve in the text that we want on the bottom of this tray. It's doing a really nice job carving this as we're going cross-grain through this Baltic birch plywood and then plunging a quarter of an inch deep to carve out that wreath design. And this bit and machine definitely handle that really well. So we got all of the fine details done as well, which is definitely nice with the 90 degree V bit. And that's gonna leave a nice pocket for us to put the epoxy in here for the color on this design. So it's gonna look really nice with the epoxy. I'm using three separate colors on the wreath part of it. So I got a red, an orange, and a yellow color. In the plans, we do lay out what colors were used and show you how you can get this exact same look. So I let that all set up and then I pulled the blue tape off and used an indigo color for the text. I used a piece of blue tape and a piece of paper to set my Z0 position up a little bit off of the material. That way we didn't carve into the actual wood. So I'm going through here and I did a first pass here and then I realized that I just wanted to take a tiny bit more off to reduce the amount of sanding that we needed to be done, and I ended up making a huge mistake here. I accidentally closed the file that I was working on. When I went to go load the file back in, apparently I clicked on the VCarve file instead of the flattening toolpath file. So I ended up trying to do a V-carve with a flattening bit, which as you can see did not work out very well. This one unfortunately cannot really be fixed, so we decided to scrap this one. I'm still going to use the material itself for the rest of the cuts, so we're going to go ahead and get those done and then we'll redo that here in just a bit. So all of the joints for this box are going to be cut on the CNC, so all the miters and everything are cut using that same RC-1141 90 degree V-insert bit. So that's what it's doing here, cutting in the miters on the ends, and then all of this will end up making a tray that will surround the bottom. If you love this type of content, be sure to subscribe to our channel and go ahead and hit that bell so that you'll be notified on all of the new videos when they're released. Also, don't forget to follow us on Instagram at @toolstoday. I also decided to use this to make some French cleats, so that's what it's cutting here, so that way we can hang it on the wall when it is not in use and be part of a display instead of having to take up cabinet space and sit in a cabinet. So that is all cut, so now we can get our profiles all cut, and you can see that we did cut all the way through the material using the 90 degree V bit, and that is very important, that way we make sure that we get the most accurate miters that we can. So using the 46202-K quarter inch down cut bit, I'll cut the dados in the sides and ends of the tray that will accept the bottom panel later on. The down cut action of this bit makes a really nice clean top surface of the material, which is exactly what you want to see here. We don't want any sort of chipping out, even though we're going across the grain on the Baltic birch plywood, which is definitely not easy to do. This bit did a great job, so we can get that all cleaned off so that we can see the next cuts. We use the auto tool changer to drop that bit off and pick up the 46170-K quarter inch compression bit. I made a mistake in setting this up and the first pass was not below the upcut portion of the bit, so you can see that we do have a little bit of chip out there. But on this next cut, I fixed that and you can see that we have absolutely zero chip out on that top surface, and because of the compression action of the bit with an upcut and downcut portion of the bit, it'll give you a nice clean top and bottom cut on the material as long as that first pass is below the upcut portion of the bit. So we use that to cut out all of the remaining parts on this tray, and then we can get that all vacuumed off and get those tabs all trimmed off using the Fine Multimaster multi-tool. So even though I did use a vacuum table here, these parts are pretty small, so a vacuum table may not hold them down, and definitely while filming everything I want to make sure that everything goes as perfectly as it can, so we use tabs just to hold everything in place. So you can see here we have a nice clean top and bottom surface on that miter and then along the edges of all of these pieces with that compression bit. So I remade the bottom portion of this tray using a different piece of wood, got everything flattened off, and then did the same process that I did last time to get everything flattened just the way that I'd wanted it. So this one worked out perfectly. I think it's important for me to show mistakes when they happen. It's important that you guys know that mistakes happen to absolutely everybody, and it's important to fix those when they can, and when they can't, you just make a new piece and everything ends up working out. So we got all of that sanded off down to the bare plywood, and I did use sanding sealer on this to prevent any sort of bleeding in the epoxy, and that worked out perfectly. So this one is now done and we got everything cut out just the same way that we did the others. So the bottom of the tray is now ready to go. So we can get all of the tabs flush trimmed. I'm using the
47116 3 flute flush trim bit to trim all of those tabs, and then I trimmed all of the inside tabs on the handle holds as well. I got the bit all switched out on the SawStop router table, and I'm using the 49498 1/8 inch radius 2 flute roundover bit to just add a nice profile to the handholds, be a little bit easier to grip, easier to the touch, and that worked out really nicely. So now we can move on to writing on the bottom of the tray. I do this on basically every project I make for the family as just a way to kind of look back on it. So then I'm adding Odie's oil to the inside surfaces of all of the tray as well as the bottom of the tray. That way it'll all be protected from glue as we're gluing things up. The Odie's oil does a really nice job popping the grain and making everything look really nice. After about 40 minutes, I was able to buff the finish off, and I really like the way that this Odie's oil finishes on the epoxy and the wood surface. So now we can get everything all assembled. I'm using some painter's tape here as a hinge. So I'm also using a piece of scrap wood here to help line everything up to make sure that it is absolutely perfectly in line and that those dados are going to match up nicely and the corners as well. So you can see here that tape acting like a hinge, allowing me to fold that up. So we'll do the exact same thing for all of the other pieces and getting everything all aligned up there. And you can see how everything will fold together. So we're going to add some wood glue here. This is Titebond 3 wood glue, and I'm just getting everything all put in there. And I did the same for all of the mitered corners. So I added the bottom tray, and then we'll fold up the rest of the tray around it using blue tape on that last one to hold everything tight. Here's another look at that from a different angle so that you can see how that goes. The blue tape does a really nice job holding everything in place while the glue dries. So the glue is going to be the strength here, and these just kind of hold the miters nice and tight. So you can see we got a nice tight fit on all of those corners there. So after that is done, we are going to add some splines to help reinforce everything. This is just a spline jig that I made for my table saw. Rides along the fence so we can get the box all put in there. And then I'm using the Amana Tool RB1020C blade. This is a flat top grind blade, which is perfect for splines. Getting everything aligned here, making sure that I'm not going to cut through the entire miter. We want to have a captured pocket here. I left the blue tape on there to avoid any sort of chip out. You can see we're just going to run that through on each corner. We're going to do 2 splines per corner. So we're going to go through and do this first set, and then we'll speed through that, and then we'll get through the second set after we move the table saw over right here. So we're lining it up so that way we get everything perfectly centered, and then we'll do the same thing on the opposite side, getting 2 sets of splines per corner. And these splines are going to help make sure that those miters stay around for a very long time. We'll get that blue tape all pulled off, and I got some stock planed down to the exact size that I need for these miters. So I got it marked out, and then I cut a little bit bigger of a triangle than I needed over on the bandsaw to give me splines larger than I need so that way I can flush trim them later on, making sure that we have a nice glue contact surface with everything. So using some Titebond 3 wood glue, we'll get that all put in there, and we have a nice little bit of squeeze out there, which is exactly what you want to see. That means that we have enough glue in there, and we know that everything's going to be fully glued in. So we did the same thing on the back one, and some nice squeeze out there again. So then we can move over to the router table using the 57187 multi-trim router. It has a bearing on the top and bottom, so it does a really nice job guiding here. That way everything is nice and flush with that surface. It leaves just a little bit left of that glue that is basically stuck to the surface that we'll do some sanding on, but it does a really nice job flush trimming these. You can definitely do other ways of doing this with like a handsaw or even just a hand plane, but this is the way that I chose to do it. We'll get that sanded down, and you can see that we have a really nice fit on those splines. I absolutely love the way that they look and really like the contrast that they give to those corners. Plus, they provide a ton of strength that will make sure that this lasts for many years to come. Using a Gator zip sander, I just went through on all the corners and eased everything over with some 220 grit sandpaper, and then finished the rest of the tray with the Odie's oil and buffed it off after about 40 minutes. Really happy with the way that this tray came out. So the last thing that we need to do here is install the French cleat. The way that I designed this is that the French cleat sits basically flush with the surface of the material. So that way it can hang flush on the wall, and then the mating piece we attach to the wall to be able to hang that tray on. So everything hangs really nicely, and I definitely really like the way that this looks. The tray came out absolutely beautifully, and it'll work great for us and provide decoration all year round instead of sitting in a cabinet for 90% of the year. Be sure to check out those plans for this project available on our website, and definitely let us know what you think about it down in the comments. Hopefully you guys enjoyed it. Have a great day, everybody. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you love this type of content, be sure to subscribe right over here. And for more great videos, click right over here.